Without further ado, I'm extremely happy to have Ambassador Orr here. As you know, he was one of the first members of our faculty, really almost the year we started, or I think 2 years after we started. He started the institute, which now is ICAS, so he's really the founder of what became this institute, so it's thanks to him that we have these programs. And as you know, he's had an extremely distinguished career in government and in business as well. But you obviously came to hear him, not me. So what we will do is we'll have a conversation, that is Ambassador Orr and myself, and then we'll open up the floor for questions. So thank you very much, Ambassador Orr, for being with us today. This has been, to say the least, a rather interesting primary campaign in the US, especially on the Republican side. For those who are not very familiar with American politics, is it the norm for US politics to be as interesting, aggressive? Is the debate we watch today a normal American debate? Or is this an exception? Well, everybody's an adult here, so we can... or is this exceptional?
Okay, I'm on. First off, let me say welcome to U.S. Presidential Inauguration Day. This is the day that the President of the United States is inaugurated, at least until 1937. March 4 was always the inauguration day of the President until that time. And from that time on, it has been January 20. Is this unusual? First of all, let me preface this by saying that I'm going to tell you a little bit about other campaigns, and I don't want you to interpret that I'm trying to equalize all campaigns. In other words, I'm trying to say, yeah, there were some nutty ones in the past, and therefore this is just as nutty, and so don't worry about it, because we've all seen it before. This is pretty nutty. but if it'll make you feel any better, there have been some other pretty wild ones. And both in the presidential elections, and of course, as you can imagine, in the senatorial and the House elections, it gets much wilder than it does at that level. But I think, you know, when I think about some vitriolic campaigns, I'll explain a couple of them at the presidential level first. I think certainly you can go all the way back to 1800 in the campaign between Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, which, you know, at one point the Jefferson people were saying that Adams was a hermetical individual who was neither a woman or a man and didn't have the softness or the hardness of a man. And this was during the campaign of 1800. And that was bad enough, but that was a very bitter campaign because it was the creation, the beginnings of the modern political party system. Because up until that time, Washington was against having political parties. But in terms of bitterness that had really terrible outcome, I think the election of 1828 was a really a sordid affair. When you had, for example, President John Adams, John Quincy Adams, against Andrew Jackson. And that the 1824 campaign had been so bitter, had been thrown into the House of Representatives, and it had an effect on the next election, which was in 1828. But to give you, backtrack for a second to 1824, because it's a great story in itself. 1824, you have four candidates. One drops out to support John Quincy Adams. The election is thrown into the House, which is the final arbiter of elections under the American Constitution. It's only happened two times. And it came down where each delegation has one vote. And there were 34 states at the time, so 18 states had to have the majority. And it came down to the state of New York, which had 24 members of the delegation. So they had to have 13 members in order for New York to go, so New York could pull the election. And it came down to one person, a former War of 1812 general by the name of Stephen Van Rensselaer. And he had been dragged into the Speaker's office. And the Speaker of the House at the time was Henry Clay and another senior senator from Massachusetts by the name Daniel Webster. Now, these are two of the greatest speakers of arguably in American history. If you can imagine getting a crap beat out of you by Daniel Webster and Henry Clay in order to vote for Adams, that's a pretty tough task to take. Well, he was, and he was an old man. And he went back onto the House floor trembling. He got on his knees and he prayed for divine guidance. And when he opened his eyes, he saw on the floor a ballot that said Adams. And he looked up to the heavens and said, divine guidance. Adams won the election of 1824 with that singular drop into the ballot box. And it was 4 years, but understandably, the Jackson forces thought they'd been cheated because one of the candidates that had dropped off was Henry Clay, and as soon as Adams won the election, he became Secretary of State. So it was called the the corrupt bargain. So in 1828, it was a bitter, bitter race. And bear in mind, the candidates at that time didn't necessarily engage, but their supporters did. The Adams people had created pamphlets with Jackson's name on it with coffins all around his name of all the people he had killed. And he probably had, or at least some of them. And on top of it, they did something that was really, really horrible and very damaging. And that is, they spread the word that his wife was a whore. Okay, and the reason why they did that is because they had been married, but the divorce papers, she was involved in divorce in the late 1790s or early 1790s, and I think the divorce papers were a couple of days late. So they actually had been married before the divorce had been completed. It was a non-issue. But because of the dirtiness of the political game at the time, they said that about her. Rachel was her name. Sure. And the election was in November. The following month, because of all the pressure of this campaign and all the nasty things they said about her, Rachel had a heart attack and died. And Jackson never forgave Adams or the rest of the opposition. And it arguably was when the American politics started to get even more vitriolic. It was a very nasty situation. And you can go on from that to other campaigns in which, the campaign of the common description, for example, of an 1884 election of James G. Blaine, who was the Republican nominee for the election of 1884 against Grover Cleveland. Cleveland forces, Democrats would say, Blaine, James D. Blaine, monumental liar from the state of Maine. Right? And they said it right to his face. So this idea of not calling liar to your face, it's got a bit of a tradition in the United States. It happens. And Cleveland, for his part, had been accused of fathering an illegitimate child. He'd been sheriff of Buffalo. And he took responsibility for that, even though it's not clear whether or not he was the father or not. But so the Blaine forces would shout at the Cleveland forces, shouting out, Ma, Ma, where's my pa? Ma, Ma, where's my pa? And the Cleveland forces would respond, going to the White House, ha, ha, ha. Going to the White House, ha, ha, ha. So, these elections do get really, really nasty. And I'll give you a couple from other examples. Nixon, as you well know, the Nixon-McGovern election may have been the dirtiest of the lot because this is the Watergate affair in the creation of the committee to reelect the president, the CREEP. But the Democrats were involved in some dirty tricks too. You know, everybody played the game. One of my favorite times was that I'm from South Florida, and I was 19 years old, and I can remember at the Republican National Convention, which was held in Miami, the Democrats had hired about 15, you know, the slogan for the Nixon campaign, by the way, was, Nixon's the one. Nixon's the one. And so the Democrats hired about 15 pregnant women with signs saying Nixon's the one. And had them march in front of the in front of the convention in Miami. So these strange games go on. I'll give you another one. You hear all the vitriolic stuff that Trump talks about. Here's is a nice quote from George Wallace, the election of 1968. Talked about dignity in politics. This is a word we're hearing a lot now, right? He said, dignity, hell, we got too much dignity in government now. What we need is some real meanness. Okay. So, you know, but the bottom line, as it's often said in Washington, politics ain't beanbag. It's the rough stuff. And sometimes it gets rougher than others. You know, as I mentioned, I'm from South Florida, and there was a famous senatorial campaign in 1950 between Claude Pepper, who was the senator from Florida from 1936 until 1950. He lost that 1950 election against George Smathers. George Smathers had been a member of the Florida the U.S. House from Florida. It was a very nasty campaign, but here's the way that tone took off. Pepper was really regarded as Larry Left Wing. In fact, when I was in Congress, I was a Capitol Hill staffer from 1976 to 1981. And I played on Congressman Pepper's softball team. He was, at the time, he had been a senator, and he came back and became a member of the House. And the name of the softball team were the Hot Peppers. So I asked some of my teammates, I said, how come you call it the Hot Peppers? Why don't you call it the Red Peppers? And nobody laughed because during the campaign of 1950, that's exactly what they called Pepper, Red Pepper, a communist. And he was really attacked for being so far to the left. But during the course of that campaign, in some of the poorest and least educated areas of my home state of Florida, Smathers would go into an audience and he would say, I want you all to know that Senator Pepper's sister is a practicing thespian and working in New York. And his brother is a homo sapien. And before marriage, Senator Pepper, he practiced celibacy. So we get, this is the kind of level we have sometimes in our political discourse. But at that, I think I'm going to turn the rest over to you if you have any specific questions on that.
One thing that's also striking in this election is that one of the major candidates, Donald Trump, has never held elected office. In Japan, obviously, because we have a parliamentary system here, Prime Minister has always been, at least since 1945, an elected member of the Diet. Is this unique in the U.S. to have a potential a man who might become president who's never been elected to anything?
No, it's not. There, that's better, yeah. Obviously, you can go way back, and which is probably doesn't have as much validity. Obviously, George Washington never saw elective office in his life. And there were some of the earlier ones. But even in the 20th century, there was a major campaign in which the candidate, the nominee, in some ways resembles Donald Trump, but in other ways not at all. And that was Wendell Willkie in 1940. Wendell Willkie was the Republican nominee to run against Franklin Roosevelt. And he had become a Republican about a year before he was a Democrat. And he changed, which is not unlike Donald Trump, who was a Democrat until relatively, well, at least we think he was. and then became a Republican. Wilkie was a guy who was actually a corporate lawyer. He had been in the Indiana utilities business, but he had always been very involved. This is very involved in Democratic Party politics. He'd raised money, you know, as Trump did for Democratic candidates, and he was nominated against FDR, and you know, he lost big. You know, I don't know if you realize this, but FDR never had an opponent ever win over 100 electoral votes against him in four campaigns. He always won over 400 electoral votes all four campaigns, even the last one. But the interesting thing about Wendell Wilkie and the Donald Trump part company is that Wendell Wilkie, in my estimation, was actually a great man. And I think that he doesn't get as much enough credit historically as he did. You know, there was a real debate in the United States about whether to go to war, especially in Europe. The country was torn. And in fact, there's a wonderful book called Those Horrible Days, which came out about 2 years ago. Yeah, I'm trying to look at all sides. That's what a politician does, you see. What happened was that Wilkie had actually felt that the United States should go to war with the Nazis. He was in favor of the war. And the reason that was important is it gave FDR political cover, so that while he was being bashed by a lot of Republicans on Capitol Hill, because Wilkie was in favor of engaging in the war, he was able to move a little bit quicker, perhaps, than he might otherwise have been able to. And then after the election, Wendell Wilkie came out as a strong supporter for the United Nations. He was a one-worlder, and he died in 1944, only 8 months before President Roosevelt. But Roosevelt, in 1944, actually seriously considered putting him on his ticket as the vice president. But at the end he didn't, and he chose a fellow named Harry Truman instead. So that was the only 20th century one that I know of, but it's an important one. But this guy turned out to be actually a good egg.
And then, before we open to the audience, what do you think were some of the key elections? If you look at the history of American presidential elections, which ones have been the most important? And perhaps, you know, as a kind of a footnote to it, before the elections, obviously the nomination of the candidate, for most people here who are even younger than us, they don't really remember brokered conventions. You know, there's always been someone who, by the time the convention starts, is obviously going to be the nominee. So if you could perhaps, because now we're talking about a brokered convention perhaps taking place on the Republican side. So most important elections, and it's kind of footnote the convention.
Okay, let me talk first about the brokered convention and what that is, and then I'll talk about what I see are the four or five most important elections. The four or five most important elections is a conversation I had with President Obama over lunch before he ran. So he asked me specifically about that, and I came up with my little list. But on the brokered convention side, political conventions really start to come about toward the end of the 1820s, but really 1832 is the first major convention. And that is the one that nominates Andrew Jackson for the second term. From that time period of 1832 until 1936, all Democratic conventions were brokered. And bear in mind that the Republican Party is called the Grand Ole Party. It's not older than the Democratic Party. It's much younger than the Democratic Party. The Democratic Party stretches back to Jefferson and Jackson. In fact, every year there's something called the Jefferson-Jackson dinner, in which the top Democrats come together. But the Republicans are created, they come together in 1856 in Wisconsin. Before that, there was the Whig Party, and the Whigs fell apart. So the conventions are brokered until the advent of the primaries. And the primaries start to come around in the early part of the 20th century. Actually, I think Theodore Roosevelt in the 1912 election, which is one of the important elections I want to mention, I think they had four or five primary elections, with the states, the people would vote, just like as you see today where we have massive primaries or caucuses. But they evolved. It was an evolutionary thing in which the primaries took over. And there were some really knockdown, bloody brokered conventions. For example, the brokered convention, and by the way, they weren't called brokered convention. That's a modern term. Because they weren't brokering. In their view, it was the party powers. The party powers made the decision. There's no brokering. It was they were brokering among themselves in the so-called smoke-filled rooms. But for example, the Republican convention of 1880 went 36 rounds, 36 ballots. So you had to have a majority. So 36 times they went around. That's quite a long time in order for them to select a nominee. And of course, they selected James A. Garfield, who was in office, sadly, only for about 5 months before he was assassinated and then died 2 months after he was shot. But the granddaddy of all brokered conventions is the 1924 convention, Democratic convention in Chicago. It went 103 ballots, 16 days. And think about this, the first convention in the history of the United States to be broadcast on radio. So the American people got to hear this, and they were not impressed. And the president at the time was Calvin Coolidge, and the Democrats had a hard time coming up with a nominee. They were two main candidates, McAdoo of California and Russell of Georgia, I think. Now, here's another additive to this, is that during the course of the convention, the Ku Klux Klan paraded, and they paraded into the convention hall in white sheet. This was the heyday of the Ku Klux Klan. This was the highest number of membership in the history of the U.S. was mid-1920s. And they paraded, and it was quite a scene. So eventually, the Democrats nominated a West Virginia banker by the name of John W. Davis. He got creamed in the election, and Calvin Coolidge was elected, the only time he was elected, because you may recall Warren Hart. He came into office because Warren Harding had died of a heart attack. So now, there have been other times when it looked like we were heading toward a brokered convention. I'm going to name just a couple. 1968 might have been brokered had Robert Kennedy survived, because Johnson clearly was leaning toward Humphrey. Johnson was the holder of the so-called establishment as the president. But with the assassination of Robert Kennedy, the powers that be, even though there was a 68 convention was a mess, mainly because of what was happening outside. But that was moving in that direction. 1976, the Republican convention was heading toward being brokered because Ford could not get a majority at the time of the convention. And I don't know, I remember this well, there was actually behind the scenes negotiations between the Reagan people and the Ford people about creating a co-presidency. I don't know if you remember. I remember it with shock, watching it on TV. They actually talked about a co-presidency, which got shot down pretty quickly. Constitutional issues, beyond that, but for a lot of reasons. And 1980, Democratic convention was moving toward a brokered, but at the end, before the convention began, Carter managed to get enough. He was down. He didn't have. He was minus 40 delegates before the convention started, and then Kennedy dropped out. So there have been few. Now let me say something about the most important elections as I see them. One, I already talked to you a little bit about 1824, 28. I think they're important, but they were so far back and the system changed so radically, I will exclude that. But certainly 1876 is big. And 1876 has often been seen as the grandfather of the year 2000 election, because the same thing happened. In 1876, there were the two candidates. The Republican candidate was Samuel Tilden, Rutherford B. Hayes, and Samuel Tilden was a Democrat. And at the end of the election, it looked quite clear that Samuel Tilden had been elected as president. But there were several states that had conflicting electoral votes. They were sending two different messages into to be counted. And one of those states was my great state that has a wonderful, wonderful history of screwing up elections. And that is my great state, the state of Florida. So you remember, and many of you remember in 2000, what a wonderful job we did in Florida in the election. And in 1876, we managed to send in two conflicting ballots, one showing Tilden winning and the other showing Hayes winning. And it really muddled up the system. And so they had to create a commission in Washington. And the commission was five members of the House of Representatives, five senators, and five members of the Supreme Court. Seven Democrats, eight Republicans. Okay. Even though I'm not going to go too deep into this, but one of the Supreme Court justices who had been chosen had been a Republican, but had been pretty neutral, but he died. And so they was replaced with someone who was more straightforward Republican. Well, they went through this commission, and there was a lot of under-the-table deals being cut. And one of the deals being cut was to end the Reconstruction of the South. So bear in mind, the South was, after the Civil War, from 1865 until 1877, it was occupied, right? And one of the deals was that the occupation would end, the troops would go back to the North, and so the deal was that Rutherford B. Hayes, they leaned toward Hayes. So the final tally in the Electoral College was Hayes, 185 electoral votes, Tilden, 184. And Hayes is elected President of the United States. He was one term as President of the United States. And he said he would only serve one term. So that's a very key election. And the upshot of that was that the occupation ended. Jim Crow came to the South. Segregation came back in full force. And we suffered for another 100 years because of the results of the 1876 election in terms of race issues in America. I think the 1912 election is very key. We're talking a lot about now the splintering of the Republican Party. That's right. Everyone, you hear it every day on ad nauseum on CNN. In 1912, that's exactly what happened. The Republican Party did split. And what had happened was, of course, Theodore Roosevelt was president from 1901 till 1909. And the election night 1905, basically he had very foolishly said, "I'm so happy tonight, I'm not going to run for re-election." He defeated Judge Alton B. Parker in the election. And in those days, when you said stuff like that, you were committed to your word. It's a little bit different today. And so he didn't run. And so he handpicked his William Howard Taft, who had actually been a very close friend of his. And Taft had been Secretary of War. So Taft ran. He didn't want to be president. He hated the job, actually. But he was much more conservative than Theodore Roosevelt. And Roosevelt still couldn't get over the fact that he wasn't president. And so he went to Africa on safari for 1 year after he was president. Very typical Theodore Roosevelt. And then he came back and he was furious with Taft, and he decided to put up a challenge. And he went to the Republican convention of 1912 in Baltimore with his progressive supporters, thinking that he could capture the nomination. And the Taft forces were then the establishment. And the conservative Republicans never trusted Theodore Roosevelt anyway. And so they did everything they could to block him. And so he simply took all of his believers with him and left the convention hall. Just walked out and went to Chicago, and then they had the Progressive Convention, which was nicknamed the Bull Moose Party, which is what most people today know it as, is Bull Moose, because that's what, because when Theodore Roosevelt was once said, "How do you feel today, Mr. President?" He said, I'm as strong as a bull moose," and that's why the nickname came. So the election of that year was very tough, and in fact, in the fall of 1912, Theodore Roosevelt was shot in the chest in Milwaukee, and he told everyone he'd been shot in the chest, and his glass case cover slightly deflected the bullet, and he said, "Ladies and gentlemen, I'm terribly sorry this evening, but you have to understand, I've just been shot." He said, "I'm not going to be able to speak to you very long tonight." And we spoke for 55 minutes. and then other candidates, here's a very different than perhaps from today. That the other candidate, Woodrow Wilson, was the Democratic nominee, Taft and Theodore Roosevelt, and they refrained from campaigning for the time when he was convalescing a bit. And they didn't. So the end result was that Theodore Roosevelt did not win the election. Of course, Woodrow Wilson won over 400 electoral votes, I think 435. But Theodore Roosevelt won 88 electoral votes. Taft won 8. And so that's the only time in the 20th, 21st century that a major political party in the United States has not come in first or second. Only time. Another important election I'm going to point to, I guess I have to move along here, 1948, I think is critical. This is where the Democratic Party split apart. And the Democratic Party, Harry Truman was very unpopular, and he was unpopular from the left and the right. And at the Democratic Convention, Harry Truman's forces took on led by Hubert Humphrey. Hubert Humphrey made a beautiful civil rights speech at the 1948 convention. You can go on YouTube and hear it, and it's quite impressive for its age. And the Southern Democrats, led by Alabama and Mississippi, walked out of the convention. And they formed their own little political party, which became known as the Dixiecrats, led by Strom Thurmond. And on the left, Henry Wallace, who had been FDR's second vice president, was quite left. He bolted from the party because he thought Truman was too anti-Soviet, too pro-big business. And they formed the Progressive Party. So you had the Democratic side dividing up into three. The Republicans nominated for the second time Thomas Dewey, who had been the nominee for the Republican Party in 1944. Alice Roosevelt Longworth, who was the daughter of Theodore Roosevelt, once wonderfully said about Thomas E. Dewey, said, "He looks like the little man on the wedding cake." No one expected Truman to win the election. You may have seen or recall the wonderful Chicago Tribune headline, and Truman waves it the next day, and Truman has this big headline, and it says, "Dewey defeats Truman." That headline was put on there like midnight, and the next morning at 11, Truman was declared the winner. So that's why he held that newspaper up, Dewey defeats Truman, which was wrong. So that was a key, because Truman was really defeated, and that kind of told a lot of people that political prognosis, at least in those days, I suspect even still, is a chancy game, It's a little more scientific today, of course, than it is then. I'm going to give you two last ones, and they're very short. The only reason I'm giving you these last ones is because I showed these to President Obama in 2007. And the reason I did was because I think sometimes the Electoral College can tell you a lot about American social change that you might not necessarily see. So the two elections I showed him, and they're very surprising because no one thinks about these, certainly one of them. That was the election of 1956. Everyone goes, 1956? See. Adlai Stevenson, you know, Kefauver, and Eisenhower, Nixon. What's so significant? Well, Adlai Stevenson was arguably among the most liberal nominees of any political party in the history of the United States. George McGovern is up there. I'm sure that a lot of Republicans today would say Obama, but certainly, you know, Stevenson was among the very most intellectual liberal nominees ever. And so you look at the Electoral College. What states did Adlai Stevenson win in 1956? Now, he's from Illinois. Alabama, Mississippi, Georgia, South Carolina, Arkansas. He won all those. Where did he lose? Massachusetts, Vermont, New Hampshire. His home state of Illinois. Eisenhower swept the country. Adlai Stevenson, the big liberal, wins the South. 1964. Barry Goldwater. It's Lyndon Johnson. Barry Goldwater is very conservative from Arizona. Lyndon Johnson's a Southerner. He's from Texas. He speaks like a Southerner. I actually understand him. And so what states does the Southerner lose? Alabama, Mississippi, Georgia, South Carolina, Arkansas. What states does, you know, and so all of these southern states. So I asked, why, what happened between 1956 and 1964? What happened to make this change? Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. Changed America. And as Lyndon Johnson himself said when he signed the Civil Rights Act, we have lost the South for a generation. He was wrong. More than a generation. Still lost it. So those are maybe too long, but that's my.
Thank you very much, Skip. I'm sure there will be many questions. If you'd like to ask a question, they should come up to the podium here. Okay, so there's a microphone over there, but it's not because the microphone's on the left that you can't ask questions from the right. So raise your hand and then who has a question? Okay, well, you raise your hand first. So you just go over here. It's because this is being recorded for posterity in eternity. Please identify yourself,
yes,
if you want, unless if you're undercover,
sure.
That's okay, you can.
My name is David Wagner. I have a question. I'm curious about your comments from a historical perspective on the role of lies and truth, fact and fiction, because it seems to me that one of the key issues in the Republican side this particular election is the amazing ability of these accusations of lies and truth, and I'm wondering if there's any historical precedent for that. Anything come to mind?
You mean When you say lies and truth, the fact that there's been a lot of, shall we say, less than straightforward things coming out of the other party, or? Yeah. Well, I think there's a long tradition of that, and I don't think it's restricted to the United States body politic as well. I know this is obviously in reference to what's going on right now, and there's a point, a psychological point, it strikes me, where the people so distrust the other side that any sort of attempt to correct into what is clearly maybe a true comment is never trusted. So the trust factor gets wiped out. And once the trust factor gets wiped out, the truth versus lie factor becomes really unclear. And that's why, you know, one of the things, you know, I've lived in this country for about 30 years, but, you know, as all of you who know who've lived here in Japan for a long time, trust, shinyo dekimasu, trust is a big deal. And so that's one of the reasons, I think, why it's so big deal. So I think that we've always faced it. Depends upon how angry people can get. Right now in the United States, there's a tremendous amount of anger. I'll be honest with you, it's very hard for me to understand that anger. I was a member of the Obama administration. You know, I'm not ashamed for one second to say I'm a inveterate, deep believer in President Obama. He's my boss. So I have a hard time understanding where the anger is, but it's there. Irrespective of what I have to say about it, it's there. And I think that makes the truth versus lie dichotomy really difficult to get around because of all the emotion relating to that. And by the way, since I'm no longer sitting in the Obama administration, I can be very frank about this because I would have been a little bit more guarded before. I frankly very firmly believe that a lot of the issues that the president faced were based on race. And I'm afraid to say that I think that's still the case.
Well, thank you. My name is James Farrer. I teach at Sophia on the other side of town. There's been a huge debate on amongst all my friends about the current election and about the historical precedent for Donald Trump. And one of the comparisons that's brought up again and again, just in all sorts of contexts, is with the 1930s in Europe with Mussolini and Hitler. And then there was a recent article in the Boston Globe that said, well, this is a bad analogy, and really we need to go back to the 1970s in the U.S. and look at William Jennings Bryan and the sort of populist movement. And I'm wondering, there's two parts of this. Is this sort of notion that an American election looks like the 1930s in Europe, is this something that's been brought up again and again in the last decades? Is this a new thing that one of our leading presidential candidates is actually accused of being a fascist, very seriously, not just rhetorically? And secondly, what is this notion of populism? Is it a useful idea at all? Is this a meaningful idea to call somebody a populist? Is there really such a thing as populist politics?
That's a great question. I like that last one the most, about populism. I may think that one out loud with you a little bit. Now, has there been times when American politics have dipped into the 30s analogies? There has been, but it's the 30s were very, in the great context of history, it's very recent, right? We're talking about 80 years. But certainly, in terms of using the language of the 30s, or using the tool of the 30s, if you will, 1968 does come to mind a little bit. And not in the same way it is here. You may recall that the Democratic Convention of 1968, the student demonstrators outside were shouting, Sieg Heil, Sieg Heil, right? And that was because they had their view was that the Johnson administration was leading an illegal war, and that they didn't have a voice in that, and so they turned it into this voice. I have a lot of friends who see the analogy of Mussolini in Adolf Hitler, and I myself am German background, and I lived in Germany a long time. I think, and by the way, when Trump's candidacy started to rise, and I thought a lot about this myself, because at that time, in the fall, I was reading a book by a guy named Andrew Nagorski called Hitlerland. Highly recommend it. It's about American journalists and diplomats who were living in Germany during the 20s and 30s. And it's what they saw. And they write, you know, and some of them got it. Some of them thought, this is evil on the march. And others didn't. Others couldn't really figure out what this was all about. But they describe scenes like brown shirt rallies in which, protesters, were beaten and how they were beaten and how they were talked down and everything. And so I must admit, I when I see some of the Trump rallies, it gives me a dark, dark feeling about that. Having said that, one big difference, I believe, or maybe I should say I hope, is that come in the 1920s, Germany was the period of the Weimar Republic. The Weimar government came about in 1919, and it lasted until 1933. The first 6 or 7 years of the Weimar government were very weak years. They were the years of the Kapp-Putsch, and the Reichswehr, revolts and all of this kind of thing. The Rentenmark and all of this thing where they were papering walls, you put all of your marks in a wheelbarrow, because my grandfather told me stories about that, to buy a piece of bread. So it wasn't until the last, like 1927, 29, 30, that the Weimar Republic actually began to strengthen and started to look like a real democratic state. And then came the Great Depression. And then the true weaknesses of the Weimar government came through. And the last chancellor of the Weimar was a guy named Heinrich Brüning, right? Who was a rather weak character anyway. But he was the real last one, Heinrich Brüning. And so by the time Hitler rises, they had a series that was Franz von Papen and Schlichter, and then they were all kind of Hitler wannabes in a way. Hitler comes to power. There were 34 political parties in Germany, 34, which Hitler spoke out about. 34 Parteien in nur diesen Ländchen, 34 political parties in this little country. I think the United States government is a stronger democratic system than the Weimar Republic was, by far. Okay? And I think that we do have constitutional halts that make things like that difficult. Doesn't make it impossible. But I do think that we're a stronger system, much stronger than any Weimar Republic. So while I understand, and I certainly don't want to test it, I think we're stronger. And populism, your last point. Well, I think that populism is I think that populism is comes and goes in strength, and it can be a great thing. I think mobilizing people, that's what it's basically about, can be a really powerful thing done for good. I mean, I don't think anybody can deny that one of the greatest tools that President Obama had was populism. It was a populist movement, and it was for good. But populism can be turned for negative purposes, too, if you have the wrong kind of leadership in there. William Jennings Bryan, as you mentioned, who was three times the Democratic Party nominee, I don't think his was a negative force. I think William Jennings Bryan, he was a populist candidate. He was actually a pacifist. He resigned from the Wilson administration because he thought Wilson was drifting toward war with Germany. Now that probably wasn't a good thing, but I don't think doesn't have to be a negative force. Is my point.
I'm Nicole Tufel. I'm a student here at TUJ. I was just wondering, when you were listing off the historic elections, how do you think that this election will be remembered historically? Do you think it will change anything significantly, or will it just be another election in our history?
Why don't you ask me that about November? Well, that's a good question, Frank. I'm teasing you. I think there are certain elements of this election that already will be pretty historic. And the real history-making part of this election would be, if it were to come about, and I'm not here to say it will, if the Republican Party self-destructs, and that would be historic. No comparison, even in the 1912 election, where the Republican Party self-destructed, it was for one election, and the ideological conflict, while it existed between the progressives and the conservatives, it wasn't as deep as this. And I have to say this, and I'm going to preface this by by saying, just to make sure that I cover my base a little bit, I am a Democrat, and I served in the Obama administration for 5 years. I also served in the Reagan administration. Okay? So I say that to give myself a little bit of cover here. And that is this. In terms of history making, in terms of the possibility of the fraying of the Republican Party, in my view, the Republicans have no one but themselves to thank. They unleashed this monster. And it's very sad. I mean, we've all seen it coming. And there were a lot of, having served in the Reagan administration, I got a lot of Republican friends. A lot of my Republican friends have been worried for a long time. Not just now, they've been worried for a long time. So, at the old biblical expression, as ye sow, so shall ye reap. And they're reaping it now. So if this total destruction comes apart, if they get into a position where at a brokered convention they undercut the guy who wins the most votes in the primary system, I think it's going to be very, very damning for the Republican Party. Now you're going to say, well, why is it so damning? Because brokered conventions happened in the past. The difference is that they didn't have the primary system in full force, where you got almost 50 states doing primaries or caucuses, and then you go back to the people after they voted on this, and that one of the candidates has the majority or about to have the majority, and you said, by the way, all of that stuff, that didn't count. Sorry. That's a real problem for them, in my opinion. So that will be the real historical test.
David Satterwhite. I'll go ahead and say that I was proud to vote in the primaries as a Democratic broad. I appreciate all of your early support of the Obama administration as well. I'm looking just the one step beyond. We are an incredibly polarized American society at this point. I remember the Vietnam War and being on one side, and it was a polarized country. I'm actually concerned that whichever one of the leading candidates right now wins, the trust factor of those who are opposed to that candidate is extremely low, I'll put it that way. And we could come out of an election, let's say a close election, and half of the country does not believe in or support the elected president. And you've had enormous depth and detail about historical cases. In what cases can you help us understand when the outcome is, even after the outcome, is severely contested and divisive? Thank you.
2008 comes to mind. I mean, frankly, that's what's happened for the past 7 years. I think, in my view, my view very unfairly, I think that the president has never been given a fair shot. I mean, you have the Republican leadership coming together on inauguration night or the night before, saying that their number one goal is to make Obama a one-term president. Now, that doesn't sound like a lot of cooperation to me. I mean, maybe I hear things wrong, but that's a real problem when you start off with that base. It kind of reminds me of in mid-January, after I joined the board of the Pacific Forum, we had talks with the North Koreans. And we trying to identify areas where we might have identified areas where we could overcome issues to, you know, step by step, so we could get some sort of an understanding. And when the other side says to you, well, the basic problem between your side and our side is we hate you and you hate us, it's sort of a tough place to start. And it's a little bit like this here. And I think that's really unfortunate. Now, going forward, because, you know, we can't sit there the whole time and think about, well, we don't like them, they don't like us, and so we're gonna fight each other, you know, forever. I think there are two correcting mechanisms, potentially. The one correcting mechanism, the beginning of it, is going to be the 2020 census. When the census starts to unfold to show the rise of the Hispanics much more clearly and the rise of other minorities and where they are, that's hopefully going to start to be a message, and it's going to change the districts, okay? And we have districts that are changed for House elections, because as it stands right now, if we're going to have this kind of a House setup, we'll never get back the House. We're not going to win the House this year. Come on. No way. But if there's redistricting, and if that redistricting reflects the big changes, we may start to see changes at that level. But we also have to go after the state legislatures and the state houses. And this is where my friend Chris Shannon back there, who's a great Democratic operative, we've had this discussion many times. This is where, frankly, the Democratic Party, at least I can't speak for the Republicans, but they failed, because they centralized the funding for their candidates, and they didn't let enough of that filter down into the localities. So they were starving for money in many of these areas. And this is a great travesty. And so we need to get the Democratic Party to start thinking not only about the presidential elections, but we need to get them funding these state elections. We got to get them funding these state governorship elections and this local election. Then over time, we'll be able to start to break up some of that stuff. That's, I think, the only long-term answer.
Hello, I'm Monica Braley, and I am a student at Temple University, and I'm just going to move the microphone down a little bit. Has there ever been such a notice during that this campaign term, there has been a very surprising candidate that's become popular on both the Republican and Democratic side, Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump, respectively. And they represent such opposite ends of the ideological spectrum. And I was wondering, has there ever been such a event any way similar to this happening before in our U.S. history? Or is this kind of a precedent of such a thing? Thank you.
Yeah, that's a good question. They're actually, usually when you see this kind of polarization, it does reflect the polarization that exists in the society, which is what we're facing right now. But certainly, the election of 1933 was a classic, in which in that case, I mean, 1933, of course, is Franklin Roosevelt against President Hoover. And they had very, very different worldviews on how to correct the economy. In fact, the 1933 election saw the highest rise of the communist candidate in America, almost a million votes. And indeed, in the 1912 election, you had a socialist candidate that also had among the highest. You know, during an American election, I don't know if you realize this, but there's often about 40 political parties that have candidates. 30 or 40 political parties. You can see it on the ballot. Some states don't run them all. Some do. 30 or 40 parties. Yeah, parties. Yeah, I mean they may be a party with 30 members in it, right? But there are. It depends on the state. They will be indeed listed, and you can vote for them. So it usually relates to that polarization. We're seeing it pretty polarized right now. 2008, I don't think, was as polarized. I think McCain was closer, you know, in many ways to the president in both ways. And even 2012, I think. But I think this is pretty polarized. Historically, you really only want to talk about the 20th century. When you think about that, but in my mind, certainly 1964, no question. LBJ and Goldwater were two different planets. So it's happened, but it's not every election. Yeah.
Hi, Chris Shannon, former Democrats Abroad Japan chair. I don't have a question so much as I just want to say, if you're an American citizen and you want to vote this election, and I encourage you to do so, see us for one of these cards with a vote from a broad address on how to do that. That's all I have. Mention the
primary tomorrow. Yeah. Thanks, Chris. I'm glad he remembered that because he asked me to say something about that and I forgot. So thanks, Chris. Appreciate it.
There's a primary running for Democrats Abroad. You can vote. Instead of voting in your state, you can vote with Democrats Abroad for your candidate. I think it's here.
It's at Meet the Hall tomorrow, 10 to 6, and Tuesday, 5 to 9.
Unless you're planning on voting for Trump, in which case we may not have enough cards.
Or any.
Yes. The Trump primary is in Macau.
Elaine Kurtenbach, Associated Press. Hi, Skip. I just wanted to ask, how about Michael Bloomberg? And is there any chance at all that he'll get into the election, into the race at the last minute, the way people are speculating? And how would that change the dynamics, considering what we've got right now?
Well, we've heard about that, Elaine, from time to time. So, I would be surprised if he jumped in at this point. You never say never, but the Republican Party is on such a hell bent on self destruction right now. But he may not want to engage in that. Want to see the thing. I'm guessing here, of course. But and I think if he did jump in. I don't think it would have a huge effect, but it would probably at the end of the day help Hillary some more. You know, probably help. I think any third party candidacy coming out of the right leaning or right is gonna help Secretary Clinton, and I think that's why when the threat comes up of a third party, the Republicans are just petrified of that notion. So, but I would be surprised to see him jump in, wouldn't you? Yeah.
Maybe to follow up, you could explain what it takes to run as a third-party candidate. Let's say I wake up and I say, well, you know, I want to run for president. Well, look, 30% of the population believes the president wasn't born in the state, so I've got to hope I can.
Well, there is no, I mean, you know, Tag is exactly right. I mean, the qualification, obviously, that's all you need. I mean, 35 years old, born in the United States. You know, the interesting thing, by the way, if I can, I mean, depends upon which state, and you have to have, and some states have requirements on how your polling number does. Some have financial requirements. It really varies from state to state. And some third-party candidates don't get on all the ballots in all the states. They're left off. That's part of the challenge. And by the way, you know, when it comes to this issue of, which was always what we were told growing up, wasn't it, Tag? I mean, 35 years old, born in the United States. So, and then we have the situation where they claim that the president was born in Kenya. And then we have the situation where Cruz, was born in Canada, clearly, but they say, well, he gets off because his mother was born in America. I never heard anyone raise that about Obama. Did you? You know, it's the strangest thing. I mean, suddenly discovered the mom was okay, you know, and everyone knew that the president's mother, for sure, was born in Kansas, and then suddenly that became an out. I don't get that, you know. So, anyway, to your question, that's my view. It's dependent upon state and also the basic qualification.
A slight correction. You said born in the U.S. It's actually natural born citizen. John McCain was born in Panama, for example.
Okay, we'll... I was asking Skip because I think what we remember from the Ross Perot campaign, which was really the last major third-party candidate, is that it actually takes an enormous amount of money to be a credible, so that to be a third-party candidate. Ambassador Numata? And then we had
Sadaki Numata. I'm sure not only myself but many other Japanese have been totally confused about the state of debate in the United States. I'm not quite sure whether we can call it a debate or not. But in order to help us understand the situation better, what adjectives or which single adjective would you use to describe Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, respectively?
How about an adjective with a noun? If it's a noun, maybe not. Reality TV.
What about the second half of the question? Now, Sanders did relatively well when you think of the fact that Clinton had raised so much money, had such name recognition. I mean, he's a fairly unknown senator from a small state. I think everybody, even the supporters, agree he's not the most charismatic speaker on the circuit. And yet, he did fairly well with his limited resources. What does this tell us about the Democratic Party primary in the state of the electorate?
Well, first of all, he's still alive, so it's not past tense yet. I think that there are a couple things. I think that Secretary Clinton, and for the record, I am supporting her on the campaign now. But I think that there was some initial challenge in terms of articulating a vision, whereas I think that Sanders had a vision that was a little easier to understand. But, you know, to be very fair and to be very honest, he was spent many, many years in the House of Representatives and many years in the Senate, and he hadn't done anything, really. I mean, he's the only thing he ever got through was the, he did some veterans benefit legislation that did have his signature on it. He pushed that hard, and I congratulate him for that. But Sanders has been able to peak, you know, push a button among a certain portion of the electorate who were dissatisfied with what many of them saw was a sort of Clinton-esque machine that had gone back since the early 1990s. And now, you know, and I don't think it was necessarily only Clinton. It was the same thing that Governor Bush ran into, and that the dynastic issues that came up that I think undermined some of their campaign. So I think that Sanders, though the numbers are not going to be with him, and I think that he is going to have to start to think about doing something else for a living. and so, at least not running for president. So I understand where the drive and the support for him came from, and I think it's really, really, really important that both the Sanders people and the Clinton people know that at the end of the day, we're one team. And that, you know, we want to embrace the Sanders people, and I hope that Sanders people embrace the Clinton people as we move forward, and realize that at the end of the day, our goals are pretty similar. Pretty similar. Not identical, but similar. And so we certainly respect and understand why the Sanders people had that kind of support.
Excuse me, I called on Miguros. Excuse me, it's Miguros-san who's supposed to ask a question. But if you want to ask your question quickly.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. So you'll ask yours afterwards. Yeah.
Japanese again, then. My question is about politics in general in the world. And now politics in Europe is quite volatile. And in many countries, including China and others, a lot of people are kind of worried about their future. You know, and I see the same kind of things in the United States. And partly because of the technological development about robots and computers arise. And so, So I think that a lot of people you know, particularly in the manual work, are getting poorer and poorer. You know, and they don't have dreams, and so politics are becoming more and more volatile. You know, and I see the many things, the similar things, in the world, and of course, Europe has a different factors in, you know, immigration and so forth. But in Japan also, we have the same kind of problems. And politics, in Japanese politics, now it's okay, you know, quite stable. But in the future, we don't know. For instance, you're familiar with the Hashimoto phenomena in Osaka, that kind of populism here and there. You know. And so what do you think of the future of the politics in general? And I'm talking about the relations between the politics and the social structural changes. Thank you.
Do I get paid to answer that one? I'm just trying to think. That's a big one. You know what? It kind of reminds me, Hiroshi mentioned this to Chris the other day. I'm reading a book, a wonderful book, a memoir of Edward Kennedy called The Compass. It's a great book. I highly recommend it. And he talks about running for the Senate in 1962. And he was in a debate with Eddie McCormick, who I guess was the nephew of the Speaker of the House at the time. And McCormick looks at, during the debate, he looks at Edward Kennedy and he said, you know, you haven't worked a day in your life. So the next day, Kennedy is in front of a factory and all of these laborers come out, dirty hands and everything. One of them comes up to Kennedy and says, he said, hey, Kennedy, is it true you haven't worked a day in your life? Then he walks up, extends his hand, slapped him on the back and says, you ain't missed a thing. So I started with that. But the future of politics. I think that, you know, you're right to point out all of the great structural changes that are challenging all of our societies around the world. And I think that you're seeing in the United States part of the manifestation of that in the extent to which we do have polarization. I think that it's a question of engaging with new technologies. It's a question of how technologies challenges the current workforce, how that scares people, how they're trying to deal with that. And in some countries like the United States, it has to do with a very dramatic change in demographics that is frightening to the long majority white population of the United States. Many of them come from the working class and other, certainly not all. And so for them, who will, within the next 20, 25 years, no longer be the majority of the United States, I think that this is a frightening prospect. And I think in other countries, while you may not have the same kind of demographic, certainly in Europe you will. How Europe engages and handles the tide of refugees is going to radically change the way politics are conducted in Europe. Now, hopefully, it doesn't radically change them to the extreme right or the extreme left. But there's that danger. And in other countries like China, it's trying to address and how to understand and bring in the masses of poor. You know, people think about China as the second greatest economy in the world. You know, having spent 5 years in the Asian Development Bank, I can tell you that there's some of the poorest populations in the whole world remain in China. And you can make an argument about how they need to reconcile their division of labor and their division of costs and capital. And I think there's a lot of truth to that, but it's still an issue that challenges them. So I think you point to the right thing. The future of politics is how we engage in these dramatic changes. And by the way, these dramatic changes are not going to slow down. They're not going to slow down. They're going to speed up.
Elaine Nadia, I was at the 1964 Democratic Convention. Outside the convention in Atlantic City, right? And I'm going to support Hillary, of course, but like many people, I'm not very excited about her. And could you comment about she'll probably win, hopefully, because of the disarray of the Republicans. And what do you expect? What do you expect? You feel that we're not going to win Congress at all, right? We're not going to win Congress, and she'll get in. And is it possible that she's going to ask her husband for advice along the way, which I hope she does, so that we can get two for the price of one? Because I love Bill Clinton. I love him very much.
Well, I mean, I'm sure she's going to ask for his advice. You know, I'm positive of that. I think that the chances of the Democrats taking back the Senate are actually quite good. Senate. Part of the reason is because they have twice or three times more Senate seats that are open and challengeable than the Democrats do. And the other reason is because if we have a nominee named Donald Trump, there are a number of questionable Senate seats, such as in Ohio, which could be in greater danger. Rob Portman's seat could be in much greater danger if he has to defend a Trump candidacy or a Trump nomination. So those questionable seats will be challengeable. And that's why the majority leader, Mitch McConnell, has basically said to the challengeable, questionable Senate seats, you're free to run against Trump, which is unprecedented in my mind. I have never quite heard of a majority leader saying, you can run against our nominee if he's the wrong guy, which is amazing. So I think from Secretary Clinton, what you see is someone who can hit the, you know, this is going to sound like a cliche, but, and I know her. I don't know her as well as the president, but I know her. And she is a very, very gifted individual. She is, in my own estimation, is that she is, in terms, I probably shouldn't say this, with a camera on me, but, okay. In terms of just basic smarts, she's the smartest of the crew. In terms of political acumen, I think the golden prize goes to her husband. That's where I have always seen the dichotomy. She is very, very, and she can really hit the ground running. She is so familiar with all of these issues. I know I can speak in international relations. I just have, I'll be publishing, hopefully, if it's accepted. The campaign asked me to write a series of op-ed pieces in her favor for Florida newspapers. Being from Florida, that has a little more resonance. If I send them to Oklahoma, nobody cares. But since I'm from Florida, you know, hopefully they'll publish a few. But my point has always been in these pieces is that she can hit the ground running. Like, there is no other candidate in either party who can do that. Certainly no one on the Republican side. I mean, the challenges for Trump are two freshman senators. Freshman senator. The establishment for the Republican Party is a freshman senator. Huh? Yeah, Obama was, but he also had a longer career in the state offices than these guys had. Except for Rubio, who had been Speaker of the Florida House. But Obama had actually more experience than these guys did. So. I mean, I really believe that the selling point of Hillary is the fact that she does have this. And the other thing, and you cannot underestimate this, the contacts with world leaders, very important. Cannot underestimate the power of what the Japanese refer to as Ningen Kanke. You know? Ningen Kanke is a big deal. And it is, I can tell you, in my business as a diplomat before, as ambassador, you know, my contacts with my counterparts throughout all of Asia and sustaining those things, that had more impact than just about anything I did.
The next question briefly, because then we'll have one more question.
Yeah. Then try to make it a little brief, because we have one more.
Okay. My name is Matthew Perez, student here at TUJ. I'd like to vote for Bernie, but I can't because I'm a resident of Guam. So there's that. But my question for you is, you know, with you've talked historically about the ups and downs of elections and just how sideways they can go. With communication as it is nowadays, with information, with the web, with the, you know, the internet, and our current candidates being as popular as Kim Jong-un right now, how do you feel that this election, how do you feel that it's affecting the stability of international relations and our the American image to the world? How's it going to affect future immigration? Are people going to want to move to America because this is happening? So just what's your thoughts or fears or hopes in regards to the election and the possible outcomes as far as international affairs?
Well, let me tell you my hope first. My hope is that at a minimum, while this might sound or look like wildness in the Wild West, no one can doubt that America has a democracy. Like it or not, if this ain't democracy, then I don't know what the hell it is. It's wild, it's woolly, it's weird, and that's what democracy is all about. And so I hope that many people in the world draw that conclusion too. That only, you know, not many places in the world would you'd have this kind of, you know, pandemonium and back and forth. Now, I think your real question is about stability. It's not now, it's after the election. That's the real question. Now, and if someone, mostly every time, when nominees are elected, there's a real dial back in the anti-propaganda because all different countries want to figure out who they're dealing with. So there's a tendency not to want to infuriate the new president, right? So they're going to dial down. Obama was an exception because there was global euphoria about a Barack Obama and the first African American president, and he was very articulate. But if they get someone in there who's not a known quantity, Hillary Clinton's a known quantity. That nothing's going to change with that. But if you get any of the other candidates, at least three of them, I think that the problem is that they're not going to be known quantities. But I don't think that the boat's going to be rocked until they figure out where these guys are coming from. You know, a lot of times during campaigns, the rhetoric gets really wild, and then it calms down and it goes to the center. You're going to see this in the general election, I believe. Very often, you know, that during the primary process, they're playing to the base. The Dems are playing to the base, you know. And then once they come to the generals, they all go to the center. And once somebody's elected, suddenly the president of the United States, it's not the same thing anymore. You're no longer a candidate. So hopefully the stability issue wouldn't be, but it could. I mean, if Donald Trump continues with his rhetoric and he's elected, it could rattle people. But I think that you have to think about it in a larger context like that.
Hi.
Last question.
Oh, thanks. Great. Hi, I'm Jody Schneider. I'm a journalist. Thank you for this grand tour of American politics and campaigns. And particularly bringing up the Smathers Claude Pepper, one of the great incidents. Two questions, they're legacy questions. The first is there a legacy, is there any lasting effect to the nastiness? You said it, a lot of times it washes out with the general. I'm not so sure that's going to happen this time. Does this tell us anything about politics and will it last, or does it, you know, Claude Pepper and George Smathers scream at each other and it goes away? And then the second question, one I think you'll like more, is what do you think the most important legacy of the current administration, the one for which you worked, of Barack Obama will be?
Well, I think that I guess I'll take the first one. The second one obviously is nearer and dearer to my heart. Legacy. I mean, there can be a legacy, and it can be bitterness, and it can last, for generation. I don't think we're quite there yet with this, frankly, because it's still a short time. And the only negative legacy so far that's being left is between other Republicans. We haven't crossed the bridge yet. And when the bridge is crossed, and if there's some real bitterness, and especially the bitterness, you know, when, if someone wins, then the bitterness tends to linger less with the winner. It's the loser where the bitterness really lingers, and the loser's party. And you get all of this acrimony. And as I mentioned before, there have been real cases. I mean, as I mentioned to you before, the 1828 election was really, it just 8 years of total bitterness of the Jackson forces. And I think in the wake of the Watergate, there was a lot of bitterness on the Republican side that felt that the Democrats had skewered them. I don't believe that, but I mean that's what their view was, and they created a legacy that many have argued is part of the dramatic push to the right of the Republican Party today. I would argue it goes all the way back to Robert Taft in terms of the vitriol between the two parties. I think the seeds were there. It wasn't all there. I think the seeds were there. So no, there's always that danger that that it doesn't get repaired at the end, and then we have to face a long time of dealing with trying to patch things together. And I could probably think, even on the Democratic side, where there have been that kind of personal antagonisms that have been created. President's legacy. Well, I think, among other things, the president is, I think the president's foreign policy, in terms of reaching out and trying to bring American foreign policy into the 21st century is a tremendous legacy. And I'm very, very proud of having been part of that team. I think the reach out to Cuba, for example, was a major, major development, a major forward step. As someone who's from South Florida and had to live for over 50 years with the absurdity of a non-relationship with Cuba, this was a great step forward. I often felt many years ago that if you wanted to get rid of the Castros, bury them in dollars. That would take care of business. And I think that the steps toward Iran were vital in terms of the nuclear understanding. I think if we didn't have some kind of a relationship, some kind of a treaty relationship with this, 10 years from now we may face problems. We would face them immediately. And we wouldn't know how to handle it. That's my view. And the other thing is, he understood how to do that, which is very important, and which I think the president has done well. He understood how to do that in a multilateral context. In that this was, and this is what people and I frustrated me on the Hill. This is not a bilateral treaty with Iran. You know, we got, you know, 5-6 other countries who are part of this process. So you just can't simply unilaterally say, oh, yeah, well, you know, in the Senate, well, we don't like this, and we're going to pull out. It's too late for that. You've already got, you know, you have a multilateral approach. So I'm proud of that, and I think the president's done a good. I think the other thing is, I think he's brought back a lot of decency to the office. You know, nobody can claim that the president is anything but above board. I've never heard any kind of corruption level at him, nothing. No one has ever said anything. You don't always hear that about presidents. So I think history is going to shine on President Obama. And I'm very, very proud to have been associated with him.
Thank you very much, Master. Well, we're sorry we couldn't get everybody who wanted to ask a question to come to the rostrum, but we didn't want to keep you after midnight. And we hope you'll be back. I just want to clarify something. The T stands for Temple University. It does not stand for Trump. So thank you very much.